Very good morning to you. You're listening to Coffee Hour, and today on Coffee Hour, we have the pleasure of hosting a true pioneer in Sri Lanka's event production industry. We have Mr. Imran Saibo with us, the Managing Director and Founder of Funtime Private Limited, which happens to be the nation's first ever event production company, and he's been at the forefront of creating, I'd say, unforgettable experiences for corporate giants, both not only locally, if I'm not mistaken, you've done events overseas as well. So for the past 30 years or so, you've been in the industry for a very long time, which is certainly a remarkable career. A very good morning to you, Imran. Welcome to the show.
Good morning. Thank you for having me here so early in the morning. This is called Coffee Hour. Where's the coffee?
The coffee comes after the show.
No worries. So you call me a pioneer, which makes me old, but still we'll carry on from there.
Age is just a number.
Age is just a number. People ask me when I'm going to retire. I say when I die. Take it from there.
That word doesn't exist in the industry.
I know.
So let's talk about what made you think of starting an event management company when event management companies never existed in Sri Lanka.
Yeah, so I was studying overseas. I finished my studies. I finished my university. I came into Sri Lanka. I was an economics graduate, so I was naturally I was supposed to go towards banking, and that was going to be my career in life. I actually applied to a bank and I was accepted. I had a 3-month waiting period. A friend of mine came wandering into my place while I was here, and he said, listen, you're doing nothing, you might get bored, there's an advertising agency that would like to have some help, would you like to go over there and try your hand at it? So I said, yeah, why not? And I walked into the advertising agency. We didn't discuss salaries or anything like that, because at that time I was just killing time for about 3 months. Yeah. And then I went in there and I got sucked into the whole thing. I started, that was the days of cowboy advertising. You didn't have internet or anything like that. So you did your own copy paste, you wrote your own advertisements, or you got a copywriter to write it for you. You designed everything. Oh. Everything was hand painted. And it was so interesting. It was a creative field that I just loved.
And it always keeps you active, isn't it?
It keeps me active, and you're never desk bound. You're not sitting behind a desk. You're always moving around. I used to double as everything. I used to be, in fact, if you go to my social media pages now and my Facebook, my personal Facebook page, you will see where the description of job is. I have said Chief T-Boy.
I noticed that.
Yes, it's a tongue-in-cheek. It's a joke, but it's also serious, because even in the advertising world, I used to carry files and go to Lake House to hand over things. Used to make tea, used to make coffee, used to do paste up, used to write, used to do everything under the sun, and it was interesting. And I did the first Luck Lane commercial, the Dankuta Posten commercial. So we wrote it, we scripted it, we directed it, we shot it, and I watched it on TV, and I was just thinking to myself, this is my work. And yep, after that, I caught the bug, and that was it. I told the bank, I'm sorry, but I won't be joining you.
You'll have to thank them for giving you that 3-month waiting period.
I know, and I have to thank my friend for just, coming into this. So there you are. That's how it all started. And then from advertising, what happened was clients used to come and say, we're doing this press conference, or we're doing this launch, or we're doing something else. And I used to take it on. And at that time, there was only about 2 or 3 people who actually supplied things to this, to what you may call the event industry, because they were doing fashion shows and pageants and stuff like that. Never corporate entertainment or corporate stuff. So I used to hire them. I used to, and every time my client used to walk in, and I used to get told off because somebody is late, somebody is painting the stage just before somebody walks in, before guests walk in, sound was archaic. So I thought this joke won't do. Mm-hmm. And I was getting more and more interested in it. So I went to Singapore, bought some equipment, came down and started off doing my own thing. And putting in the whatever I had learned from overseas, like, timelines, punctuality, all that kind of stuff. And then started the event company.
Very interesting. And off air, we spoke about why fun time. It's definitely fun. It's definitely fun being in the industry. Yeah. And Imran, I understand with the wealth of experience you have in the industry, you would have met different types of people, different types of clients now, both locally and internationally.
Yeah, I did.
So speaking of which, now times have changed.
Yep.
And you mentioned about how you need a copywriter, and then again about how everything should be hand-painted back in the days.
Yeah.
But now it's completely different. So what's your take on the evolution of the industry?
I'm in two minds, because sometimes, you see, I don't know if the internet is a blessing or a curse.
I think many people have that problem, have that question.
I know, because what happens is... The tendency is to go onto the net and to, you know, grab a few ideas, take a few pictures, put it onto a mood board, go and present it to a client. Sometimes, some of those pictures that are grabbed off the net and shown to a client and saying, this is what I'm going to do for your event, you can't even reproduce it here. So the client looks at that, and then he walks into an event, and he looks at it and he says, this isn't what I was expecting. So what I always say is, you can grab your ideas. It's a nice place to go and just, you know, browse. But at the end of the day, you need to focus on doing your own thing. You need to get creative. You need to know how to shape it to the event that you're doing. You know, it's like an artist drawing a painting. Same thing.
Very true, because it's difficult to give realistic images to the client, because obviously they don't understand how you have to do it and the resources available, because they feel like if the event management company says so, they can do it.
You know, you're presenting something which is up there in the air. It's all in your head. So you can only give them an idea. But so far, it's been good.
Yeah. Nice. So what about the expectations from the client's end as well, Imran? Has it changed like over the years, and how do you deal with them?
Well, I've been lucky. I've a lot of clients who have been with me over the years. We've grown to know each other. Actually, what I always say is in a lot of interviews and a lot of these things that I've done, I've said, a client relationship with his event person is not like it's not like something you're selling a commodity, and you know you're the supplier and you're the client. It's actually teamwork, working together. So as you create an event is very it keeps changing. And the thing is, you and the client sit together, and the change is for the good. So you have a base that you start from and you go on. So when you have a client who understands this and who knows that you're going to put in a little things here, put in a little things there to make the event better, there's a trust established. Once that trust is established, the client doesn't move. In fact, I've had clients who do some very frightening things. They come and say, Machan, this is our budget, do the event. And then they're not asking me any questions. They're not asking me what I'm doing, how am I doing it. And I keep going back to them and saying, hey, I'm doing this. Is it okay? And they say, yeah, you know it now, so you do it.
They've given it to the maestro. We don't have to bother about it. We have our work to do. He'll do that job.
You know. But once you learn their pulse, once you learn. But I always say there are a few things that you need to be 100% with. One is audience profiling. I keep insisting, I keep asking people, who's coming there? You know, are they English speaking, Singlish speaking? Are they bilingual? Are they trilingual? What strata of society they come from? Because each time an event is designing an event.
Exactly. You need to know your target audience.
Exactly. It's not a matter of putting a few LED screens, putting a couple of singers on stage in a band, and that's not an event. That's just another, you know, bajau.
I like how you said that. Well, but we see a lot of event management companies coming up in Sri Lanka. And over the 30 years, I'm pretty sure you have a lot of competitors now.
Oh, yeah.
You've inspired many of them. And obviously, people grow, and there's technology, there's internet, and, you know, there's exposure to the other side of Sri Lanka and all around the globe. So you know what's happening, and, you know, things are easier now to get down stuff from abroad and all that. It's not like
it is
back in the days. So how has Fun Time adapted to all these, and creating an event, it's all about creativity. So let's talk about that side of it.
So I always tell people, and they don't believe me, that I have done things in that first, in the first glory days, which hasn't even happened, which doesn't even happen now. I used to work with a company called Kashyapa Theatre and Film Lights. They were actually film set people. We have built inside the Hilton ballrooms and places like that stage sets without LED screens. There were no LED screens, nothing, which actually touched the roof of the Hilton. We've done the Cleopatras. We've done it all, and we've done it with sets. We've done it with people. With, you know, and it look pretty out of this world. Now there's a tendency: take a couple of LED screens, put it all around the hall, put you know, and then you put some graphics on it, and you got an event. That's not an event. That's very far from it.
I can kind of picture what you're saying.
Yeah.
But we see that a lot, don't we?
I know, I see it. In fact, sometimes I'm responsible for doing it myself. It's the easy way out, but it's not LED and all that is fine. Technology is fine. I mean, we worked with Parcans. We didn't work with, you know, color washers and scanners and stuff like that. But you need to know how to use it. Mm-hmm. In fact, last weekend I was doing Bishop's College. I did three nights of Epic Black, as it was called, with a group called With My Feet. Absolutely brilliant dancers, brilliant performers. But what I did was, there was an LED screen, but each set that I built for them was static. There was a slight bit of animation. There was nothing else. It was like you didn't detract from the thing itself. And even the lighting was programmed from A to Z. So I knew where I hit a spot. I knew where the drama is created. You use those elements to create a mood and an atmosphere, but you never detract from the person on stage.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a lot of work involved, and I'd say
it's a lot of work.
It's a lot of creativity and work, and a lot of planning.
A lot of planning.
And let's get to that as well. But we do have some music lined up for the show So let's move on to some music, and we'll be back.
Sherry, Sherry lady, living in devotion.
That was Modern Talking on the show. You're listening to Radio Sri Lanka. We went back to the 80s and we are in the future now.
In the future now.
So let's talk about the different types of events you've handled, Imran. Now, I understand that you target corporate events as well, but then there are traditional events, cultural events, national events, international events. So talk us through the journey of events and which has been like your utmost favorite so far.
I think if you are really passionate about what you do and if you're really, really into what you do, you have what you call, what I call milestones in your life. And in my event life, there have been milestones which stand out for me and which I think, oh man, this is what I did. And you always want to leave something back for posterity. You want to leave something saying, this is what I did. And, you know, you're not going to beat this kind of thing. So, so the milestones that I've had, I did a six-hour non-stop concert for Sri Lanka in the UK at Trafalgar Square. 25,000 people amongst those lines that you see in Trafalgar Square, 80 performers, massive stages. I did it for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs for Sri Lanka in conjunction with, I think, the mayor and the councils of London. It was brilliant. I was like on pins. I didn't know if I could pull something like this off, and it went brilliantly.
I mean, I don't know. For me, as a compere, I'd say sometimes when I'm on pins, that's when the best output is.
You know, you're quite right, because that's the adrenaline rush that gives you the that gives you the power, that little bit of extra. I always tell people, if you go into an event and you're not nervous, then there's something wrong.
There's something wrong, because that's the exact feeling I get. Because sometimes if I'm very chill before an event starts, I'm like, no, this is not good. I need to be nervous.
You need to be nervous. You need to know that your heart should be pounding. You should be wondering, am I going to do this? And that's a good feel. And at the end of the day, when you finish it, you're like, oh, wow, I've done it. So that's
the best feeling ever.
I know. It's not the money. It's not nothing. You don't think of all those things. So there was Trafalgar Square that I did. Most recently, I did the Expo in Dubai, represented Sri Lanka for Expo Dubai. And there was this Al Wasl Dome where, you know, Alicia Keys performed, Coldplay performed, everybody performed. And I was determined that Sri Lanka should perform there. And we being a small country, they were giving us another venue somewhere else. All I didn't do was get on my knees and beg, but I said, I need this place. And I finally got it. And with the Chana Vijayawad and the troupe, I went there and we did a performance, which was really wow. I still have it on record, and I can still remember that feeling when I came to the end of the performance. You know, it was a hair standing on end feeling. that's a feeling that you don't get
often.
Mm. So that was one more. And then another thing that I did was, I don't know if you've heard of Danata. Danata is the parent company of Emirates. They had come here and seen something that we had done. And for the first time, they hired an event production company from Sri Lanka to totally do their event in Dubai.
Wow.
And I took out a crew there. I remember even the videoing was done by Pro Imager Mohan Fernando at that time. We traveled there. We shot everything. And then we put up the screens, the stages. The artists came from here. And we did an event. And it was huge. And then came the Maldives. And I have launched about 5 resorts in the Maldives.
Oh wow!
For a group of companies there, and they've all been good experiences. I work with a lot of airlines. I work with Oman Air. I work with Singapore Airlines. I work with Sri Lankan Emirates. All of them, and it's been a good journey. And I've met some wonderful people along the way, and still meeting them. I'm still doing stuff.
Exactly, and that's what keeps you going.
Now, that's keeps me going.
I mean, it's easy now to tell everybody that, you know, I've done this, I've established myself in the industry, people know me, and we have competitors. I mean, that's the best feeling ever when you have competitors, because you know that you made it. But Imran, it was obviously not an easy journey for you. For somebody who wanted to, who studied and have to literally get into banking, but have made like a huge twist.
I know.
And you're doing event management. So tell us about the rocky path.
You know, until you said it, I never actually realized or never thought about it, because I was so into it. It was a music. It was everything else. It's a lot of sleepless nights. It's a lot of stress. It's a lot of tension. But if you ask me what I would like to do again, if I ever had the chance, I would say the same thing. Because when you say a rocky path, you hit certain areas. Sometimes I go into an event and judge myself. The client comes up and hugs me and says, thank you very much, and that was beautiful and great and all that. But I have put into my head, no, this was wrong, this was wrong, this was wrong. And I sometimes go home thinking, you know, absolute depression, thinking I could have done this better, you know. But yeah, that's how it works.
Feeling.
Yeah. And I always tell people, your the event that you do today, you forget about, because people will come up and say, you're the best, you're this, all that. In the next morning when you get up, you start all over again. If you let it go to your head, if you get illusions of grandeur, if you think you're the best, you're gone.
Yes, exactly.
You won't be there.
Exactly. Because, I mean, that feeling is what makes you. Because end of the day, when you know that you made a mistake, when you know that you could do better, and if you don't focus on only the compliments you get.
Yeah, that's right.
Because they say constructive criticism is the best way forward.
And I think self-criticism is the best, because, you know,
then nobody does it for you.
Nobody will do it for you. So you need to be able to, you know, say, I can do this better the next time. I can do it. But so far, thank God, all the events have been successes. I've not had anything ever come up in all these years. But the one thing that I know is that my clients as well, I've met some lovely people, and they've become friends over the years. My forte is high-end clients. You know, even in the corporate world, it's a different kind of clientele. It's not the usual tamasha that I go for, though I do admit that sometimes a client will come to me and say, you know, after party. I know what after party means. But even that, you can fashion so that it's different from everything else.
There's some creativity put into everything.
There's creativity, there is experience that you bring to the game.
Memories.
There's a whole lot of things that come into it.
One day, I mean, like recently, I came across this quote where they say, we are very comfortable working for someone for 40 years, but trying to build our own thing, we're not comfortable waiting that 3 years.
Which is very true, actually. Yeah,
that really hit me hard, actually. Because the moment I saw that, you know, you're very comfortable working for somebody else for 40 years, but not comfortable building your own path, and you don't have the patience to wait for 3 years. So I'm like, that's so true.
It is.
And I think it probably took you more than 3 years to...
I know.
Be where you are, or maybe satisfy people at home.
Yeah. No,
are you still doing that?
In a sense, it's a transition.
Mm-hmm.
See, because when I started doing something called Rock Saturday. You might have been too young to even come into one of those. But Rock Saturday was at the CHNFC. It was something that I did because I liked doing. Then I did the Wild West shows. Actually, from all time onwards, we were doing these shows. I've even done carnivals. And all kinds of things, but then it just kept evolving, and then and now it's all high end stuff. It's a very different corporate world that I work in, and it's corporate entertainment that I work in. But I always tell even people who are coming into the field, just knowing how to put a light on, or how to put an LED, or do some nice graphics is not what it is. You need to have a wider knowledge, a wider range. So you need to be reading, you need to have hobbies, you need to have a whole lot of different interests in life, which then feeds into your brain and comes out in your creativity. So I still, even though I have a lot of people around me who do stuff, and I have people who create graphics for me, I have people all that, but at the end of the day, I spend a lot of time thinking it out as to what I would want, how I would feel.
Would you call yourself a perfectionist?
I'm actually a perfectionist, and I can be quite a pain being a perfectionist to all the people around me. In fact, Billy Fernando actually mentioned this in a little endorsement that he did for me, saying that he's scared to do events for me.
I badly wanted to ask that question.
No, because you want it to be perfect. So I have this policy of 100 things can go wrong. Get ready for 99. The other 1% you have to do on the fly.
Wow.
So, you know, so you need to go through every... I sometimes refuse. Recently, there was a pitch that I was supposed to do for a company that had never, or long years back, had called me in. Now, recently, they called me in again, and they wanted me to do a pitch for a product that they were launching. And I just, with the other events that was there, I just didn't have the time. I had the idea in my head, but I didn't have time to translate it on. And I didn't pitch because I thought I didn't want to do something half-baked. So I thought, okay, just let it go. And I let it go because events is not about money. I always tell people it's about the passion you have. The money will follow. Sometimes I get a budget. I spend out of my margins. The profit that I was supposed to make is not as much as I expected. But as long as the event is good, that's the main thing.
Exactly. I mean, not everybody would feel the same way because this world,
yeah,
and the country especially has
yeah, it's all about money. No,
change people.
Yeah,
I think.
But if you're doing it for money, forget it. Go and get into some other profession. Not events. It's not worth it.
That was very direct.
Yeah.
So what I mean, that could be an advice for people who wants to get into the industry and who wants to, if they have the passion for it, as you say.
You have to have the passion. Mm. Without the passion, nothing works.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you have to feel it. You have to want it. So otherwise it doesn't work.
So we're in the final few minutes of the show, Imran. I hope you enjoyed.
Yeah, lovely chatting. I didn't get any coffee, but anyway,
I told you,
that's fine.
After the show.
After the show, okay.
After the show. So nevertheless, I need to know what you're a very creative person. So what should the future look like for the event industry?
For the future of the event industry, I'm noticing here locally. Actually, I'm going into Australia next week to do a show there in
Melbourne.
That's
why I got hold of you today.
Yeah, I'm launching Turkish Airlines, Turkish Airlines Cargo in Aussie. But the thing is, locally to move forward, I think we should be able to tell clients this is what you should be doing. We should be able to look at our audiences a little more. We shouldn't just take things off the shelf. It's not a sausage machine. You know, you don't just put LED screens, a lighter, sounder, this thing, three or four artists, and an MC, and say you got an event. You haven't got an event. You have to dream it, imagine it, from minute to minute, second to second. When you have that in your hand, then it all comes together like a jigsaw puzzle. And your client will come up to you and say, brilliantly done. And that's the feel-good part of it.
Exactly. And I think for many, it's passion, and some it's money, I'd say. But being in this industry, I guess it applies to people on television, media in general.
To everybody, in the entertainment business.
Exactly.
Even singers and artists should be, you know, they shouldn't be singing the same songs every day. They should be, you know, they should be looking at their work. They should be bringing out new stuff, new ways. And even an extra intro into a band or whatever it is, you need to design it. You need to look at it. And you can learn a lot. In fact, a multinational bank, which I did an event for about 2 weeks ago, came to me, and the one thing that they said to me which I felt good about was the fact that they came and said, you're the only one who can do this, we're coming to you.
Wow.
And I did it for them. It was very important to them, and I did it for them. And I know that I was a pain in the neck to them because I asked them 150 questions. I used to, you know, do things. I used to do testing and all that. But at the end of the day, the event worked out so brilliantly that their head from their region or wherever actually came and complimented them and said, we should replicate this in the other countries. So for a small country like Sri Lanka to say, for them to say something like that was quite
major.
A good feel. Yeah, it's major.
It's certainly major. So I did mention that many people are inspired by you to start event management companies.
Hopefully.
I've seen that happening. Okay. So, I mean, you've seen that happening over the years. And who has been your inspiration, Imran?
You know, you won't know this name, but a long time ago, there was a gentleman called Donovan Andre in this country. He's the one who bought in Holiday on Ice. He's the one who bought in so many different shows into this country. Holiday on Ice he did with ice that was packed from Elephant House or Ceylon Cold Stores and made into ice skating rink. I mean, he pulled off crazy stuff, and he was a person. I was a kid then, but I learned from them. I watched them.
Observing,
and you know the kind of things that they were pulling off in a country which didn't have the resources. It's not like in the UK you just make one call, or in the West you make one call and everything is there. And then I grew up with people like Chris Greet, the compere, Arundhas Bandaranaike, Chris Greet, you know, the Desmond De Silvas, the old musicians, the Manilals. They sang for 25 rupees. You know, they sang because they had passion. And Arundhas Bandaranaike is a fount of information. He is, you know, we were just talking about him when
exactly,
you were coming.
Yes.
His knowledge of jazz and everything else is so brilliant. So, you're like a sponge. You take things off them, those creative people that you meet.
It's about knowledge sharing, I'd say.
It's about knowledge sharing, and it's more like, you know, it's nice to be around them.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So thank you so much, Imran, for sharing all these amazing stories with us.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me on your program.
And I'll make sure you get your coffee.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much once again for accepting our invitation and for being
a
part of Coffee Hour.
Thanks a lot.
And with that, it's time for me to say bye-bye as well.